Hello guys, good morning. Hope you're all doing fine, right? Please stay at home and study, all right? So let's jump back to the video. Last class we have seen about turning tools and pounding tools, right? In the last four videos I've explained about it. Hope you all learned it very well. A lot of people asked me a lot of doubts through WhatsApp and mail, so thank you so much. We will jump on to the next one, okay? Holding tools. So as you can see in the figure itself, I think you have figured it out what is the holding tool. Suppose you have a workpiece in your hand that you want to cut or drill, whatever you want to do, and one more tool you are having in the hand, okay, the tool that you're going to use on the workpiece. All right, now can we hold both the workpiece and the tool both in hand and do the operation? No, we cannot do that, right? One reason is the power, we may not get it, okay? When you keep something in the ground and then use whatever you want to do, the power will increase. So with both hands we cannot do a simple operation. But there is one more danger to that. Like I have explained in turning tools, with the screwdrivers I told you, suppose you are taking a small avionic instrument, okay? So you want to remove the small screws from it. So you take the particular shape screwdriver. And if you are holding that avionics equipment, if it is a small equipment, you can hold it in hand, right? So if you're holding it in your hand and using the screwdriver at the same time, the screwdriver, if it slips, definitely you'll get injured, right? Definitely you'll get injured. So this is the one reason we cannot just hold certain equipment in hand or a workpiece in hand and use a tool also in our hand, okay? So either one of the things should be separate, okay? So in that case, you can go for holding tools. All right. Now I have given 3 points here, so I have classified it into three categories. The one you can see is clamps and vices. Okay, so you can see here these are the pinch vices, and these are the clamps, and this you can commonly see in workshops. Okay, in the benches it will be there. If you want to fix any sheet metal work or light duty work, you can go with a clamp. I mean, very thin metals, you can go with a clamp like a C clamp. If it is a thick and heavy metal, we can go with a vise, okay? And then we have pliers. These we can go use for electrical appliances like the wires, okay? Cutting wires, stripping the insulation from the wires, okay? When you're doing that, we have to hold it from other side, right? In aviation, we don't want to hold the wire in hands, okay? Remove that. So we have some pliers in there. And the third point, special fasteners for holding. So this is very important because in aviation, it's not coming under aviation maintenance. During assembly process in aviation aircraft manufacturing, they will be doing this, but it will be very helpful for you to know it, okay? We will see about those special fasteners. Generally, fasteners means like a bolt and nut is a temporary fastener, right? We can fix it and we can remove it. When it is installed in aircraft, it will be a permanent fastener, okay? It should be because we are giving some torque load to it, okay? As we have seen in last class, the class before last class about the torque wrenches, okay? We are giving some specific amount of torque, okay, specific amount of tension to the bolt and nut, so it will be a permanent fastener there. For example, rivets, they are permanent fasteners, but there are some fasteners we are going to use just for holding for some time, okay? That we will see in see is the last topic, okay? So let me go to the next one. Clamps. I will start it with clamps, okay? Now we can see in this figure, as we have seen in last class about pounding tools, right? So there is a punch, there is a hammer, we are hammering the punch. Now the thing is, so there is a sheet metal here and we are punching the sheet metal. Suppose there is a location marked here for drilling and we are going to do some punching there. So don't you think we have to hold this sheet metal? So it's not easy to hold the punch, the hammer, as well as sheet metal. So in that case, the clamp will act as another hand for you, okay? So you can fix the sheet metal in this clamp and then you can do the work so that your punch will stay exactly in the position. Otherwise, we may not know, our body may disturb the sheet metal because we will be standing close to it, right? Our body may disturb it, or we may, while hammering, it may wander here and there, okay? So it's always better to clamp it than do the work, okay? So those are called temporary, okay? So temporary clamps, okay? That's why I've given here temporary and permanent, two clamps, okay? So permanent is like what you're seeing here. So this is actually a wire bundle, right? As you can see, these wire bundles you can commonly see in aircrafts. All right. So this wire bundles you can commonly see in aircrafts, and you can see a clamp here, okay? So these wire bundles are clamped to a structure, okay? Now why it is clamped? Suppose if it is not clamped, what will happen? Guess. These wire bundles will wander here and there, you know, when the aircraft is flying. At one point it may, you know, these joinings may break. It will keep on sliding here and there, and then touching this metal body, right? At one point the insulation will go away, insulation will damage. Then definitely when the copper that is inside this wire is exposed, and again if it is touching this metal part, it will lead to electrical sparks. So many accidents have happened because of that. Okay, that's why in aviation maintenance, they have adapted this electrical wiring interconnection system, a separate training program. Okay, like what you will you'll be having human factors training program, right? Fuel tank safety. So because there are certain accidents that happen continuously over a period of time due to the, you know, maintenance errors, okay? Because nobody is going to maintain wires, right? Wires will be kept in some place and it will be kept there for a long period of time, right? So they made a separate training program for that. So in that they are telling the safety of electrical components and the wires, okay? So you can see here, that's what I'm going to explain, that these clamps are permanent clamps. Okay, once it is installed, it will be there. You can remove it, but still it is installed in the aircraft, it will be permanent, okay? So these are permanent. But these clamps, what you're seeing here, will be used in workshops and machine shops, okay? Just for holding. Suppose you want to do riveting of two small plates. Suppose this is one sheet metal. You're going to rivet the sheet metal with another sheet metal. So we have to hold it. We have to clamp both initially. Okay, then only we can rivet it, okay? So it will prevent the movement or separation as well. Okay, this clamp is actually called C-clamp, okay? It's called carriage clamp. You'll see that here. It's actually commonly called carriage clamp. Why? Because it is a portable clamp. Okay, we can carry it anywhere and then we can fix any bench in there. Because if you see the jaw here, this is a frame we can use to hold, and this is a threaded jaw. This is a fixed one, stationary one, and you can move this jaw up and down. All right, so how it is sized, you can see how it is sized. So it is sized based on the dimension of the large object that the frame can accommodate with the screw fully extended. All right, and if completely extend the screw, so that much you can use, okay, that much you can use. And when the screw is completely extended downwards, you can see some part of the screw will be there, right? And this will be this portion, the swivel head will be above this clamp. Right, this swivel head, this will be here. So this will be approximately 1 inch if you consider that. So it, given here, it will vary in size from 1 inch upwards, okay? So from 1 inch up to here, it will vary. Okay, the 1 inch is because of the size of the swivel head, okay? Now these are flat, right? So they can fix on any plates, clamp on any plates temporarily, all right? Now one more important thing you have to consider is, so I told you, right, this is a small clamp and it can be used for thin metals, right? Suppose we are using an aluminium, if you are tightening it too tightly, what will happen? Definitely you will mar the metal, okay? So you will, you may scratch the metal or something. So for that, we have to use a masking tape. I have given in the fourth point. So you have to use a masking tape. I will show an image for it. Now what you can, what you are seeing here is a manufacturing of a wing spars, okay? A group of guys are doing manufacturing of wing spars. So I have taken from that. This image I have taken from that. So what they are doing is, they want to fix some additional structures to the aluminium sheet. So they are clamping it everywhere. Okay. So as I told before, aluminium is a thin metal, right? So if you are clamping the aluminium metal, you see here, they are using some white color thing below that clamp swivel head, right? So that is called this tape. It's kind of a this tape, okay? Masking tape, okay? It will be in paper form or it will be in plastic form. So why is this required? You don't want that clamp, the clamp should be tight, but if it's a thin metal, you don't want the clamp to create any dents or impressions or scratches in the aluminium, okay? So for that, you have to use masking tape, all right? Next, we'll go with this is an old type of clamp we can commonly see in machines, okay? This will be also in machine shop. So this also has two jaws. You can see here there is upper jaw and lower jaw, and there is a center screw. Okay, so with the help of this center screw, what we will do is, suppose this is a these are two plates that you want to clamp together so that you want to, you can drill in the one particular location you desire. Okay, so in that case, you can use the center screw and tighten it. Okay, you fix the two plates inside with the help of center screw, you tighten it so it will hold it. Now we have to apply more pressure to hold it perfectly, right? So then you can use the outer screw. Okay, use this outer screw and then screw it. This outer screw. Okay, so tighten it. So you read the second point here. The end of the jaw, there is another screw that will exert pressure on the other jaw. Okay, so when you're tightening it, it will exert pressure exactly here in the both jaws. Okay, so it will keep it tight. So the one thing that you may do mistakenly is, first thing you have to use this screw, then only you have to go with this. If you're improperly using it, then the part may be held holding there, but the pressure will not be applied there. So when you're taking this into the drill machine and drilling there, this plate will fly away. Okay, so this is, you have to do, you have to take care of fixing these screws. Okay, so that's one important thing you have to remember. Like I have given in the last part, care must be taken to keep the jaws in parallel position. Okay, it should be like this. If it is like this, then you may not it will hold the metal, but we cannot expect the perfect pressure is applied there or not. When you are using this in machines, like I told you before, it will fly away very easily. Okay. So this is one type of clamp. So it can be also called a parallel clamp because it should be held parallelly the jaws. Okay, so it is also called tool maker's clamp. Okay, where you can see, like I told you before, in drill machines like this, you see this is called angle plate. Okay, you can find this in workshops. Okay, what is the use of this is, suppose if you don't have any provision here for fixing your metal for drilling, you can take an angle plate and clamp the angle plate. So you see the bolt here, right? So this bolt is fixed through this slot provided here and then bolted to the sitting frame of the drilling machine. Okay, so this angle plate is perfectly fixed with the help of a bolt. Then here you can use this clamp. Okay, this is a tool maker's clamp, a parallel clamp. So this is a metal that you want to drill. Okay, so that is perfectly fixed inside. So with the help of these slots, this tool maker clamp is fixed inside, and on the other side, the material that you want to drill is kept. All right. So like this, this clamp can be used. Here we cannot use a C clamp, right? The C clamp is like you want to hold two parts, two materials, like I have given here. Either you can keep it in a bench and hold it, or we can wait a minute. I can't be able to scroll my PPT. Yeah. So here we cannot use a C clamp. Okay. Just assume if you are using the C clamp horizontal lenses, it will come down. Okay. It will not fix it properly. So in that case, we can go for a tool maker's clamp. But nowadays, machines, they are having their own setup here. Machine clamps are there. And we will see later on. We call it as machine vise. Okay. We'll see that for separate machines, there are separate machine vices are there for heavy duty, because there is a heavy duty drill bit, right? So if the drill will be rotating at a high speed, we don't want a clamp that is not going to hold it very lightly. We want something that will hold it very tight. Okay. So next one is vise. So like I told before, if you want to go for heavy duty holding, for example, like the image I have shown here, so there is a steel bar given here and the man is trying to cut it with the help of a saw, right? So we cannot hold the saw on one hand and the steel bar on the other hand and cut with both hands, right? It is not easy, right? Because we have to give some more pressure. Like I told in the first slide here, there are two reasons why we need a holding tool, because we cannot give the right power by holding a tool in one hand and the workpiece in another hand and then do whatever the job you want to do. We cannot get the right power. We have to keep it somewhere and do it. And while keeping also, we have to secure it perfectly. That's why you need a holding tool. Okay. Now, if you want to do for heavy duties like this point I have given here in the first point, sawing and drilling, then you have to go for bench vices. Okay. They are commonly called bench vices because they will be fixed in the benches in your workshops and machine shops. Okay. So how it is measured for a clamp, we can see the capacity, right, from the civil plate to the end of the screw. The full jaw length is the capacity. Here also we have two jaws, as you can see here. One is a fixed jaw that will be fixed in the table, And the other jaw, it can move. It is movable, okay? With the help of this handle here, we can rotate it and move. It is a threaded handle, okay? So we can move this jaw. So up to this much it can move, right? So this will be the capacity, okay? And the width is also important. The width of each jaws is also important, all right? So why this is much better than your C-clamp or toolmaker's clamp is, I read the last point. So why is this also depend on a screw to apply pressure, like the handle here, okay? So when you're rotating the handle and you can tighten it very tightly, and it also have gripping ability beyond that of a clamp with the help of a textured jaw, okay? This brass will be having some texture, like for gripping facility, okay? It will be serrated, to say exactly. So the serration can hold it. But here also, if you want to use thin aluminum sheet, then we cannot give too much pressure, okay? It's better to clamp the aluminum sheet on the table with a C-clamp or a toolmaker clamp, okay? That is much better. Now here we have some types we have here. So this commonly what you are seeing in your machine shop is a utility bench vise, okay? Some salient features of this bench vise is, like I told before, it will have serrated jaw, so it can be holding, you know, tightly. It will give a lot of grip. And the other thing is, you see in this area here, a pipe, circular of this can be fitted here, okay? Like this pipe that is fitted, being fitted here, okay? So circular objects can also be fitted here for cutting purpose or filing purpose, right? And in the back side of this jaw, okay, here also we have two jaw, one is adjustable, one is fixed in the bench here. So in the back side of it, you have a anvil face, okay? So in this case, we can do light work, like suppose we want to hammer this here and there for closing any dents, then you can keep it here and do little hammer work, okay? That's why they have given this anvil face. And you can see the base here, that is a mechanism they have given here. This bench base can be rotated completely, okay, with the help of this swivel base. Okay, you can rotate this jaws fully, 360 degrees, all right? And like I told, if you want to use any soft metal here, still we can use it. How? Because how is like these caps? We have some jaw caps here. These jaw caps can be fitted in these caps, fitted in these jaws. Okay, you can see a small provision here. So this can be fitted there, and it can be screwed inside. Okay, so this will be made of the same soft material like whatever the aluminium, brass, or copper jaws. Okay, if you want to do any cutting in aluminium, okay, and that needs very strong holding. Suppose we want to use any metallic electric or power cutters to cut the aluminium, then we have to fix definitely in a vise. Okay, so then if it is a soft metal, then we have to use some pads like this, okay, pads or caps, okay? So that this will avoid the gripping, okay? When you're doing any heavy duty operation in a soft metal, this grip will damage the sheet, okay? So you have to provide some caps, okay? You can also use wood. Suppose you have very thin sheet metal, okay? Two sheet metal you want to cut with the help of a machine or something. Then we can provide wood facility, okay? I mean, small woods that you can cut and you can keep on both sides and then clamp it completely with the help of this. Then we can cut it, okay? You can back up with a wood or you can back up with a cap, all right? Now, utility bench vise, they also call it as a machinist vise, okay? The machinist vise, we will see how it is differing from this utility bench vise. Now, this is a machinist vise. Machinist vise means it will be used in machines, okay? Like what you're seeing here, this is a saw, okay? Abrasive chop saw, and this is some drilling machines. And here you can see the clamps, okay? Like I told before, here, we are using a toolmaker's clamp, right? There's a hand clamp. We have to use with the help of a hand. But in nowadays machines, we have the clamps in the fixed itself in the machine, okay? Like what you are seeing here. Okay, this is some kind of a drilling machine. And here you can see a big machinist vise. Okay, this will help in holding the metal. Okay, you can move it here and there. This provided the mold connection in these slots. Okay, so it can be moved, and you can see the angle they have given here. So this can be completely rotated, okay? So it is completely flexible, you can fix it. And this one you can see here, this is actually for cutting, okay? is a cutting tool. It's called a chop saw. This blade is made of abrasive. This is an abrasive material. Okay. So, and here this one is a machine vise. Okay, machine is vise. You can see the handle here. When you rotate this handle, this part can be moved backwards and forwards. All right. And the back side you have one black panel, right? That is your fixed jaw. And this is your mobile jaw. Okay. So in between you can keep any metal, and then you can cut it. Okay. So this is what I'm trying to tell. For each machine, there is some separate vise. Okay. These are some examples I'm giving. So those vices are called machinist vise. Okay. Generally, what you are seeing in workshops, in benches, is a bench vise. We call it as utility bench vise or bench vise. All right. This is a machine. One more machinist vise you can commonly see in drill machines is drill press vise. Okay. And you can see the slots provided here. These slots can be fitted in drill machines. Here you can bolt it in the drill machine, and then here you can fix whatever metal you want, and then you can do the drilling process. Okay. Like what I have shown here, it is similar to that, but this has a swivel base. Okay. So just remember, there is a utility bench vise and a machinist vise. Okay. And this is one of the machinist vise I am showing you. Now these three are some heavy duty, right? It will be fixed in a place. For example, this is fixed in a bench, and this is fixed in a machine, particular machine that it is made for, right? Now we have some vices that can be held by hand. Okay, as you can see here, this is a toolmaker's hand vise. Okay, so it has the same like a vise. It has one adjustable. This is adjustable jaw, and this is a fixed jaw, right? Now here we have provision sizes. There are some slots cut here, so we can keep vertical pipes. Pipes vertically we can fix here, or pipes you can fix horizontally here and tighten it. Then we can do whatever the cutting process we want. Okay, if it is a light duty, then we can go for a tool maker hand vise. Okay, otherwise you have to fix in a bench vise. Okay, if it is a heavy duty. And these blocks are interchangeable. Okay, you can just take it out and change based on the type of material we want to fix there. Based on the shape of the material, so if we want some pipe or any circular objects, the help of these slots, it can be fixed perfectly there. Okay, these slots will make sure that circular object will not bend there. And this, we want to any rectangular square shape objects to be held, we can go for these kind of blocks. Okay, here we can do small machine operations like drilling or tapping. If you want to use a hand drill machine, okay, I will explain about hand drillings in a separate chapter. Okay, and tapping also I will explain in a separate chapter. So tapping is nothing but making threads, okay, with the help of hand. There are some tapping tools, taps and dies. Okay, and drilling machine, we have hand drills. So this light duty operation we can do with a tool maker hand vise. Okay, if you want to drill with some power drilling and all, power drilling and all, then we can go for a bench vise, or we can directly go to a drill machine, okay, with a drill press vise. All right. Next is combination hand vise. Now, this is one type of hand vise, but still we cannot hold it in hand. Why it is called a hand vise is because it is portable. Okay, you can take it here and there. That's what's called a hand vise. That doesn't mean we can hold it completely in the hand and do the work. Okay, you cannot do that. And for that we have separate vices. Okay, like this. If you want to hold it in the hand, then you can go for these vices. All right. Like what you are seeing here, this is a combination hand vise. Why it is called combination hand vise is either you can hold it in the hand with the help of a handle. All right. This is a separate vise. This mechanism will explain after this. Okay, leave it here. So take this part. This you can hold with the help of a handle, and you can fix whatever object you want. You can fix here, and you can do small filing, any small work. Suppose you want to cut with a cutter, okay, like snips. Then we can use this vise, okay, to fix the metal here and use the cutting tools, okay, for light operation. Now, if you want to do heavy duty operation, then you can go with the same mechanism can be fitted with the help of a clamp, okay. It will come with a clamp, so it can be fitted like this. The clamp will be clamped to the table, and this combination hand vise, it can be this threaded portion, this handle can be removed, And here you will have the threaded screw. That screw can be fitted here and with the help of pinner, and it can be clamped onto the table like this. Now this will look like a normal bench vise, right? It's a small, looks like a small bench vise. Right? So here we can fix the metal and do light works. Okay. These are actually old tools. Okay, nowadays we have machine vises and C clamps and all. These are old tools. Okay, and one more hand vise that comes handy is a normal hand vise. Okay, it does not have a big mechanism at all. A small spring loader mechanism here, and there is a wing nut here. Okay, and here you can hold the clamp with the help of this wing nut. Okay, sorry, hold the material with the help of this wing nut. Okay, and this we can do very, very light duty operation. There is a small sheet metal that you want to do filing on the side, or same like cutting with the help of a cutter or snips, and you can go for these vices. All right, just remember the names and how it looks. Okay, that's not that much important. Though. Then V block with clamps. Okay. So there is a lot of important use for this. You can see why it is called a V block is because there is a block here, rectangular block, and it has a V groove here. Okay, so 90 degree groove is made here, and there is a rectangular groove here. So this groove can be sliding in any big machines. Okay, like what we have seen here. Okay, in these areas it can be held and it can be sliding, like how it is, how this vice is seated. Okay, like that you can see it a V clamp also. V blocks with clamps. Okay, so it will come with a clamp. What you can do, since it is a V shape, we can easily hold a circular object like this. Okay, so with the help of the clamp, you just hold a circular object. Either you can, if it is a small circular object, only one block is enough. Okay, if it is a big object, then we can go with a, we have to go with a big and thicker one. Then you have to go with two or three V blocks with clamps. Okay, then you can do operations like this. And these are actually old methods. Nowadays we have different separate vices between machines. Okay, and there is one more important use of this one is laying out of measurements. So we have seen in a layout, layout and marking tools, right? So in that I have told you, suppose you want to suppose this is a shaft. Okay, suppose this is a shaft. You want to check whether this shaft is perfectly straight or not. Whether it is perfectly straight or not, how can we find it? Whether it does not have any bend or eccentricity, how can we find it is perfectly straight? We can fix a instrument called dial gauge, right? If you don't remember, take my notes and read a layout and measuring tools. So dial gauge can be, it will have a, it will have the same kind of this is actually a drill bit. So the dial gauge will have the same kind of measuring pin in the end of the gauge that you can fix here. And you can simply roll this shaft with your hand and see whether the dial is changing or not. Okay, so take the layout and measuring tool I have shared with you in the first class of this chapter. So there I have given with good examples. You can read that. Okay, there also these V blocks can be used. Okay, so these are old way of using, these are old methods. So what we have seen so far is clamps and vices. Okay, clamps can be used for light duty, and this is a tool maker clamp. A C clamp can be used for light duty like this. A tool maker can clamp can be fixed in machines like this. And vices, we have small hand vices as well as machinist vice and bench vices. All right, next we will go with pliers. Like I told before, there are some other objects that needs to be held in hand. Okay, like small tubes, wires. Okay, small steel rods. Okay, so for those we have to depend on specifically designed tool holding called pliers. Okay, so now so in this, we'll start with the types. First one is a combination plier or a slip joint plier. Okay, so why this name has combination? If you see the jaw here, the jaw of this plier, it has a flat jaw, right? Flat design in the front. So here we can hold these thin sheet metals kind of objects, okay? And in the back side, we have a small circular jar and a big circular provision, okay? So this we can hold some smaller and bigger circular objects, all right? And then we can use for this for holding, okay? This for holding. And why it has the name of slip joint is because you see the joining here, the pivot point, it has two holes, right? It has two points actually, pivot points. So we can just extend the jaw like this, okay? We can just pull it apart. So this screw will go to other side. So the capacity of this jaw can be increased, okay? Once it is pulled apart, the jaw will increase its capacity, okay? That's why it's called slip joint. The jaw can be slipped into different pivot points, okay? So the serrated jaw is for the serrated jaw. We have a flat jaw, it's for holding flat materials, okay? And this one, these and these is for holding circular objects, okay? And in the end of the blade, you see here, in the end of the jaw, there will be a small blade will be there, cutting blade, okay? So there we can cut short wires, okay? We can cut wires, or we can strip the insulation of the wire also with the help of that blade. Why? Because the blade will be having some shearing action, okay, like this. It will not be perfectly straight like this, it will be a shearing action. So we can just remove it and then take it out, okay? Now one important thing we have to note down here is, you may think this has serrations, right? And it can hold circular objects. So we may think we can use this to turn a nut, right? We have wrenches for turning a nut, right? But some people may think, okay, it can hold circular objects, right? And it has very good serrations. So we can take it and turn a nut, right? No, we cannot do that. That's what I've given in the last point. Don't use a slip joint to turn it. Why? Because these jaws will be a little bit sharp, okay? So it will round off your nut corners, okay? Then we cannot use a wrench to take it out, okay? Once the flat design of the nut is gone, we cannot use a wrench there, okay? So you don't think you can use this in nuts, okay? We cannot use that. So these are the different use of this slip joint plier, all right? Next one is interlocking joint plier, or we can call it some water pump pliers. Listen, this is not important for us because in aviation metals we are not gonna depend on this. This is actually used in plumbing operations. You just remember why it is called, it is also called tank and groove pliers. Why? Because you can see this is one jaw and this is another jaw. These both are joined with the help of a gear mechanism here, okay? It's called the tank and groove mechanism. So it can be moved up and down, and the capacity of this jaw can be increased, okay? It can hold small nuts as well as big nuts, okay? And it also has long handles, okay? Long handles, so that we can easily apply a lot of force, okay? As I told in torque wrench, if you have a long handle, the length is more, the tension torque will increase, right? Next one is wide grip pliers, and this one we have already seen in, can you guess? We have seen this in turning tools, especially in wrenches. It is also called lever jaw wrench, okay? It can be used as a wrench, it can be used as a plier, it can be used as a wide grip also, right? It has various purposes. The important thing that you have to note down here is, it can be used to hold a pipe because it has this rounded jaw design here with serrations. It can hold pipes. Like I told before in the turning tool class, we cannot hold pipes that are plated or coated with something, okay? It will damage that coating, all right? Now, how this is used? Actually, this will, I hope you remember that, right? So when you use this screw in the back side, the jaw in the lower jaw, it can be held in tension, compression with the help of this spring, okay? So it can be kept in a place. So it can be used as a holding tool, okay? I'll show an example. Yeah, this one. So we have so many holding tools, and wide grip is a very good tool for holding. So how it is used, you will see here now. So first you open them by pressing the release lever, okay? So what is this? Here you are seeing a small lever, right? So if you press it, the jaw will get loosened like this. Okay, the lower jaw will get loosened like this. Now how it is getting loosened? Because we have a toggle mechanism here. Okay, so you can see there is a straight plate here, and here also there is a plate. Okay, so these two are connected with two different nuts. Okay, so when you press this lever, it will just toggle, so it will get loosened like what you are seeing there. Okay, so this plate will be straight and this plate will become little perpendicular to it. Okay, so it is going opposite side. All right, so like that it is open, then you just close it. So when you close it, you can see the jaw is having some big capacity. Now this person is going to rotate this screw in the back seat, okay, of the top jaw. Okay, so when you are turning this knob, you can see the jaw is closing on that screw, particular screw. So once it is closed, what you can do, it's perfectly tight now. Okay, but you have to make sure this grip has to be used as a holding tool, right? The grip has to stay there. So what you can do, once it is touched there, you can release it again, then give little more turn. Then if you press it, you will hear a sound, a toggle sound. Okay, now why you are hearing that sound is because we have a plate here and there is a plate going there. Okay, you already gave some tension in the spring with the help of the screw in the back seat, right? So when you try to press it, it will toggle, it will give the sound similar to the toggle, the sound you are hearing in a toggle micrometer, right? The same sound you hear there. Also, we have same mechanism, right? I hope you remember it. If you don't remember, go back and check the video on torque wrenches. Okay, we have the same toggle mechanism there. So once she presses it, it will get fixed there. Then, so you can see where she is using it here. So she's holding the one side of the screw and then turning the nut on the other side. Okay, like this we can use it. And here also we have to note one important thing is, so when you are giving more grip, okay, we have to make sure we are not damaging it, because this will be very powerful when you are holding, when you are pressing it, it will give that sound to make sure it is gripped properly. Okay, so don't over tighten that screw. Okay, otherwise the jaw has all those serrations, it will grip that screw or whatever you are holding very tightly. Okay, so like I told before, it will grip very tightly, then it will become a problem. Okay, let's come back. Yeah, okay, so that action we call it as a toggle action or compound lever action. Okay, so this mechanism similar to a ratchet mechanism we are seeing in lot of tools. So this compound lever action also we will see in lot of tools, this toggle mechanism. So there are some other vice grip pliers that can be used for cutting wires and pinch off hoses. Okay, since it is giving some power when you are holding it, it is giving some power, right? You will hear a sound. So these jaws will be having different designs for cutting wires and pinching off hoses. Okay, hose is nothing but a flexible pipe. All right, next one is needle nose plier. Why it is called needle nose, you can easily guess from the design, right? It has a needle nose. This is a long nose actually. These are also called long nose pliers. Okay, so in the long nose plier we have two types, one is needle nose and one is round nose. Okay, so it has actually, if you see the jaw here, see here, it is actually half round. Okay, so exactly the portion where you are going to hold the object is flat and the portion around is semicircular. Okay, so where it is used, so you can see here, it is used to hold wires or small objects and to make loops or bend in electrical wires. So it is mostly used in electrical applications. Okay, in avionics, right? And it also have a small cutting blade here. Okay, so that can be used as a wire cutter or for removing the insulation. Okay, and it also have insulated handles. So you can see, since we are using this in electrical applications, we can use this. So since it is used in electrical applications, it is having insulated handles. All right, so we have wire cutters there. That wire cutters can be used for cutting the wire or cutting off the insulations. All right, for reaching into places that you can't go there, they are having some bent varieties. Okay, with the different angles. So one image I'm showing here, there are different angles to it. For this also, I will show a video. It will clear your mind on how it can be used. This, yeah, this one. You see how this line is going to do? It's going to explain. So we can use it to cut the wire with help of the blade in the end of the jar. We can cut different size oils. Okay. Then you can remove, just by swiveling action, we can remove the insulation alone. Okay. Like I told before, both the jaws will be actually having a shearing action. Okay. So by turning it like this, we can easily remove only the insulation. Then with the help of the flat jaw in the front, you can actually make loops like this. Okay, if you want to connect this wire with some other wire, or if you want to connect this to some terminal lug in an electrical system, then we can make loops like this with the help of this holding. So this is a very good holding tool in terms of electrical appliances. Okay, so like this also we can do. Go inside and fix this screw. Okay, we can take it from one side and we can use our other hand for holding the screwdriver and turning. All right, these are the various uses of this needle nose pliers. Okay, so the round nose plier, it also similar to that. The design is different, right? It is also having long nose. So these two are varieties of long nose pliers, needle nose and round nose. Okay. So it is having a completely wrapped design. Okay, it is completely circular. So where we can use this? I think we cannot use it for holding anything. We can use it for crimping that. Okay, in the olden aviation days, they were using it for crimping it. Nowadays we have crimp tools that will specifically crimp two different wires very easily. Okay. And next is one important thing that we will be seeing here is safety wiring tool. This is also a holding device. We're going to use this for safely wiring nuts and bolts. Okay, we'll see how it is used. So, see the image I have given here. So, there are two bolts and there are some holes in the sides of the bolts. Okay. And the help of some steel wire, it is locked. So can you guess what is the need for locking these bolts with the help of wires like this? Okay, actually these wires are locking these nuts. Can you guess how? As you can see, generally we can lock this bolt by turning it in clockwise direction, right? With the help of a wrench, right? By clockwise direction, we can tighten this bolt. If you want to remove, we have to go in anti-clockwise direction, right? Now, this is locked with a wire like this, right? If you try to turn this in anti-clockwise, will it come out? No, these wires will not allow it to turn in anti-clockwise. That means you cannot remove this in anti-clockwise. So where we can use this kind of safety wiring? In parts, we are having vibration, okay? So in parts, we are having vibration, like in engines. Especially in engines, we can find all the nuts and bolts will be having this safety wiring, okay? Some the nuts will be having nuts will be mostly of castle nuts. Okay, like what I will show in torque wrench class, the castle nuts and the locking nuts. Okay, those nuts will be used in the backside of the bolt, and the bolt will be safely wired. Okay, so how much safety here they are providing? First, you have to think that the first safety is, as I told in torque wrenches, they are torquing it to the right value so that the right tension is set on the bolt. Right, we are actually giving some load, preloading the bolt. Right, we are preloading the bolt with the help of torque wrenches. Okay, we are using the torque wrench to give the torque on this bolt, so there will be some tension in the bolt. That is called preloading the bolt. Okay, we are preloading the bolt with a tension. Okay, and after that, we are providing safety wiring. All right, this much on the back side, we are providing some lock nuts. Okay, in the back side of the bolt, there will be lock nuts. So, this much safety is. Why it is required? Because if these nuts go off, then the parts will vander. If the parts vander inside engines areas, we cannot achieve safety, right? It will definitely damage the entire part. Okay, so that's why these bolts are highly secure. Okay, and of all this, this one method is safety wiring. Okay, one method of providing safety is safety wiring. Okay. For this safety wiring, we have to hold this safety wiring with the help of some special tools. Okay, we cannot just use our hands. In olden days, they were using hands as well as some pliers to do this. Nowadays, we have some special tool that will easily do this operation, okay? Generally, these wires are also made of stainless steel, galvanized steel, or brass wires, okay? Like given in the third point, okay? So here also, they are providing safety here, okay? These steel wires will not get corroded very easily, okay? This is made of material that will not form rust, okay? And you read the last one. This wire pulls on the fastener in the direction of tightening, so that vibration cannot loosen it. So it is safely wired. This bolt is safely wired in the direction of tightening. All right. So this side it is trying to pull it like this, and this side it is trying to pull it like this. Okay. In clockwise direction it is pulling it. So it will not go in anti-clockwise direction. All right. Now you understand what is the need for safety wire. Okay, it's similar to using torque wrenches to give torque values. Okay, there is one safety for holding the nut and bolt in the place. This is a safety, another safety. Okay. Now this one, tap pill plier. Okay, this is one of the oldest tool that is being used in olden days for doing this safety wiring operation. As you can see in the jar, it is completely flat, right? So you can easily hold the wire in one hand. Steel wire in one hand and hold the other wire. We can hold another wire also in another hand, but we can use a double ply. Okay. So like that, we can use this plier. Okay. So it is called double plier. Why? Because this jaws looks like a bill, the mouth of the duck. All right. And there is one more mammal that has this double design in the nose. It will look like this. I will show you a video for this, but let me explain the other things also. Because, this is actually a cutting tool, a diagonal cutting plier. So why this is used? Because suppose you are doing this safety wiring with the help of one hand and one double plier, and then turning it like this. So after finishing it, you may have some extra portion like this, right? Now we have to cut it off. So for that, we need a cutter. Okay, that the cutter should chip it off very nicely. So there we can use a diagonal cutting plier. Okay, once you completely cut it, we have to make a pick tail. Okay, pick tail means you have to rotate it and keep it. Okay, we cannot keep it as it is straight. Okay, it will damage, it will injure people when they are assessing in that areas. Okay, so there we can use a diagonal cutting plier. Okay, it is commonly called dykes. Okay, diagonal cutters or dykes. You can use for cutting and stripping electrical wires, and also for cutting safety wires. Okay, it is one important thing. So this is also used in electrical areas. Okay, and cotter pins. Okay, this we have seen in last topic of the torque wrenches last class. Okay, cotter pin is actually the castle nut. The back side of the castle nut, there will be cotter pins. Okay, so those pins can be cut by this, because that cotter pins will not allow that castle nut to come out easily. So we have to cut it out. So how this name came, diagonal cutting? You see the jaw here, okay? The end of these jaws are perfectly sharp, okay? But the remaining part of the jaw is diagonal, okay? How it will be used is, well, most of the cutters will be having shearing action like this, right? But this cutter will be perfectly straight on its jaw. If you cut by pinching, okay? One jaw will hit another jaw perpendicular to each other, okay? It will pinch it off very nicely. So once these two just cut some wire, the remaining diagonal portion will just push it out. Okay, so that's how it got its name of diagonal cutters. Okay, now where we cannot use this, that is one important thing. We cannot use it for cutting rivets. Okay, suppose if you are using rivets for if you are doing hand riveting. Okay, and once you fix the rivet, if you feel like the rivet length is too big for making that joining, then we can cut the rivet. Okay, for that we have special rivet cutters. Okay, we cannot use these kind of cutters. Okay, because this will not cut the rivet completely in the length. It cannot be used to cut steel wires or rods. Okay, big wires. Okay, small wires it can be cut, but we cannot use to cut with steel wires or rods. Okay, and there we have special tool called snips. Okay. The snips we can use for sheet metal, okay, but there we cannot use these kind of cutters. The snip will look similar to this. I will explain it in cutting tools, okay, but the cutters, the jaws will be different for snakes, okay? And this we cannot use in sheet metal. Because sheet metal also we need shearing action, okay? But this does not have shearing action, it has pinching action, okay? And in electronic components such as transistors. So this transistor element you are seeing here, okay? So here this cannot be cut with a diagonal cutter, okay? It's not recommended for that. Because they cut with a pinching action, that can damage the sensitive element. Like this is actually pinching, okay? One jaw is hitting another jaw and cutting it out, okay? So most of these rivets and this sheet metal cutting, this transistor elements, this has to be cut with shearing action, okay? Then only it will cut properly. So this is not suited for such operations, all right? So these two are combinedly used, okay? First you have to use a double plier and then do the safety wiring, then we can cut out with the help of a diagonal cutter, okay? Nowadays, we are using a special tool called safety wiring twisting tool, right? So if you see this tool, it's very handy to use. If you see the jaw, it is completely flat jaw, okay? And at the end of the jaw, we'll have a small cutter here, okay? So what we have to do initially, to make a loop like this, and fix the wire in the jaw like this. Okay, once you fixed it here, then you can see there are two jaws, right? This is one jaw, this is one jaw. This jaw will be, you can just press it inside this portion and lock it, okay? Once you locked it, this jaw will perfectly hold this wire, okay, tightly. Then in back side, you have a lever. You just pull the lever. So this lever is actually threaded inside this portion. So when you pull it, this tool will rotate. Okay, so once it rotates automatically, it will twist these wires uniformly. Okay, so the twisting operation, you are just achieving it by holding it on one side and then just pushing the lever back on the other side. Okay, so this is very easy to use. All right, so once you have done the wiring, so up to what length you want to cut, you can use the cutter in the back side, you can cut it up. Okay, so like this, it will form uniform twist. All right. So once it is cut, then we have to do a pick tailing in the end of the wire. Okay, we don't want to keep the wire hanging like this. We have to curve it. Okay. So with this I will show a video. Let's see here. These guys will explain it very nicely. So these are some big gas turbine engines we are having. Right, these are aircraft engines, very big engines in fighter jets, gas turbine engines. And you see the screws here. You can see the screws, it is having some safety wiring, right? You can see these big screws. There is a wiring that is going there, here also. So everywhere around the engines, and here you can see very nicely. So all these screws in line are, each and every screws are safely wired. Okay, so it is locked. It will not allow this nut to come off very easy. So everywhere around the engine you can see. Here also, this hose connection, here also you can see. So wherever there are bolts, critical areas in engines, there you can find safety wiring. Here also you can see. So in and around engines there is safety wiring. Let's see a simple tool on how to use it, okay? So like this, one jaw can be extended, okay? You can see here, one jaw is fixed with this tool, the lever. Other jaw is movable, okay? So this jaw, once you fix that steel wire here, you can just lock it by pushing this jaw into the lever. It will get locked inside. Then, the backside handle, the lever, you just pull it out. This tool will automatically rotate, okay? So I'll explain it. So first what he is doing is the first safety. The first line of safety is perfect torque value, okay? Giving the right torque. So he is doing that, okay? He's setting the right torque to the nut there. So once it is done, then he is showing the nut that is going to join this bolt is made of a locking nut, okay? It will have some locking feature inside. like what we have seen in torque wrench. Okay, either it can be a castle nut with quarter pins, or it can be a locking nut that will have plastic bushings in the end that will not allow the nut to come out automatically. Okay, it will be very tight. You have to use a torque wrench to run it down. Okay, so that is second line of safety. Once you have fixed it perfectly, then we have to do safety wiring. Okay, like what is doing. So there are some holes in the sides. So we just wiring it like this. So you can see which direction is twisting. That is very important. See, these nuts can be locked up from clockwise direction, right? And it can be unlocked from or removed from anti-clockwise, right? So he is making sure the steel wire is on the other side, the locking side. This is going to pull this nut in the locking side, and accordingly is twisting the wire also, okay, on the direction of locking, that is clockwise direction. So with the help of hand, and you can see there is one side he is holding with the hand, and other side you can see this duckbill, okay, duckbill fly. This is a old method. So once it is done, you can use a diagonal cutter, then you can cut it out, okay, like this. Then what he is doing on the second screw, second nut bolt, he's taking the safety wire and twisting in opposite direction there. Okay. Now here you can see he will twist in opposite direction. I mean, there he was twisting in this side. Now here he will twist in other side. Why? Because so here he was rotating this side, here he was rotating other side, okay. Why? Because then he will lock it on other side, okay. He will lock it here. So because these nuts can be locked in clockwise direction, okay. And here, clockwise direction, okay. It's coming. So this steel wire is perfectly holding this nut in clockwise. And here also he will rotate it on other side. Now you see the tool here, or the tool that he is using, that is a safety wiring twisting tool. Okay, so initially what he is doing is making a single twist. Okay, he's just making a single twist. Okay, one twist, and after that twist he is just holding it with the help of the locking player. Okay, then he will press the handle and lock it, then he will pull the lever in the back seat. So once it's, so see what he's going to do, he will pull the lever, then it will automatically rotate. Okay, automatically make this uniform twist. Then he will cut it out to the required thing. Then he will lock it. He is going to twist it in the direction of clockwise. Yeah, like that. Press it. That's all. And he will turn it down. You don't want the sharp edge to pointing outside. Now, what he has done is, generally nuts will be, bolts and nuts will be locked in clockwise direction, right? So he made a steel wire such that this nuts will not go in anti-clockwise direction. Even when the part is vibrating very highly, these nuts will not come out because it is locked in clockwise direction. It will not go in anti-clockwise. Okay, and this nut also, you can see this, there will be a lot of tension. This wire will be pulling this nut in this side, and this part will be pulling this nut in this side. Okay, both are clockwise, so the nut will be always tight. It will never get loose. And this is a need for safety wiring. All right. So these are the tools generally used for in electrical appliances for holding, okay, pliers, okay. And safety wiring, we have seen one plier, ductile plier, and diagonal cutters, okay. Or we can directly use a safety wiring twisting tool, okay. Next, what we are going to see is just a simple topic. You don't need to know much about it. Holding fasteners, okay. Generally, fasteners means bolt and nuts or rivets, right? I think that is going to hold something together, whether it is permanently or temporarily, okay. A rivet is a permanent fastener, okay. Once you put riveting, we have to damage the rivet, break it, and take it out, okay. So that is a permanent fastener. Bolt and nuts are temporary fastener. You can remove it anytime you want. So this, what we are going to see here is holding fasteners, okay. this will be temporary. Okay, so where we are going to mostly use this is during the assembly process. Okay, during the assembling of components. So the two holding fasteners are clicko fasteners and wing nut fasteners. Okay, when I was starting this class, I told you about wing nuts. Okay, wing nuts are, you can see, in different places, but there is a fastener called wing nut fastener. We'll show that. Yeah, you see this image. So this is a war aircraft. Actually, in during World War times, there is the woman. Actually, most of the women will be involved in the assembly. Okay, so this is one image I have taken from internet, from a website. Okay, so there, when I was reading there, they explained it very nicely. There are a lot of images. Okay, and you can see what she is doing. She is holding a power tool, right? You can see it is a pneumatic tool. You can easily see based on the hose. You can see it is a pneumatic tool. So what she is doing is, she is doing riveting. All right. So she is doing riveting in the fuselage panel, okay, of some war aircraft. Now, what are these things that is protruding outside? Can you guess? You can see here. Here the riveting is completed, right? Here the riveting is completed, right? So first, what they will do? First, we need for riveting, we need to drill the hole, right? So once the rises, hole will be drilled everywhere, okay? So initially they will drill a pilot hole. Pilot hole means all the hole will be same size, very small size. Okay. Suppose here we need a different size hole, on here we need a different size hole, means first what they will do, they will make all the holes of same size. We call it as pilot drilling. Okay, starting drill or pilot drilling. So once the parts are assembled perfectly, so they will put this clicko fasteners inside. Okay, these are just temporarily will hold it. Okay, so all the parts will be placed properly. Now wherever we have to use that different size drill, the person will drill there. Okay, then the correct drilling will be, the riveting will be done there. Okay, suppose now these are temporarily holding it, right? Suppose you want to do the riveting here, you take the clicko fastener out and then do the riveting there. Okay, like that. You can take one by one and do the riveting. Okay, we cannot just bend that fuselage panel, keep it there and then do riveting. That is not easy at all. Okay, sheet metals will always try to roll out. Okay, so first we have to make sure it is folded properly. Okay, so with the help of this fasteners, it can be temporarily hold. So when you want to do riveting there, you take one fastener out and then do riveting there. Okay, so this is the clicko fastener. Okay, you can easily identify how it works. It has a plunger, like a pen we have, right, the top. So like that, the kind of plunger is there. So when the plunger is pressed, okay, this rod you are seeing here, right, spreader, it is called spreader. Okay, the spreader will come out. When it comes out, we have two jaws on both sides, right? Those jaws will open. Why? Because the spreader is actually a triangular shape. Okay, it's actually a triangular shape. Okay, like this. So when this triangular shape comes out, the length will increase, right? So accordingly, both the jaws will expand. Okay, so I will show a video for this. You will easily understand. Yeah. So you see here. So what he has done initially is, there is a special wrench for using this tool. Okay, you cannot do it with the hand. You can see this wrench here. So there are two jaws on this wrench. One jaw will, there is a protruding portion here, right? One jaw will push this portion upwards. Okay, the other jaw will hold this one tightly. Okay, so other jaw, you can see the top jaw that will be on the top of this plunger, and the bottom jaw will, when you press the handle there, the bottom jaw will push this yellow color part upwards. Okay, why? Because when you press it upwards, this jaw will close together. Okay, so then you keep it inside and release it. Okay, now he is releasing the handle. What happens automatically? This will go down. Okay, now we can see here. So he has pressed this upwards. Okay, against the plunger. So it is, the spreader is inside. So both the jaws are close to each other. Okay, then he will put it inside. Then when he releases it, it will come down, the spreader will come down, the jaws will expand, and it will get locked in that place. Like that. That's all. Okay. So you can temporarily hold it like this. Okay. So here, if you want to put some 10 rivets along this, so there will be some 10 drilling holes, right? So in all 10 drilling holes, we keep a cleco fastener. Okay. Then remove one by one and put the rivets. So it can be very good tool. And you want to do a lot of riveting, okay? Especially in aircraft, they will be doing this, okay? Now, the one more variant of this is a wing nut fastener, okay? So this cleco, we are not providing the right amount of pressure, right? We are just clicking it and make sure it is holding, okay? Now, if you want to tighten it too much, if you want to provide too much of holding, suppose in these areas, if you see, the sheet metal has bent too much, right? So here there will be a lot of tension. Okay, if this fastener is not enough to hold the sheet metal in the place, then we can take a wing nut fastener. Why? Because here you can see the wing nut is a screw. It's actually a nut and bolt, right? So when you are turning it, it will be having a lot of tension. Okay, so you can compress it and tighten it very easily. Okay, similar to this, you keep it inside and turn this wing nut downwards. Okay, it acts like a nut, bolt and nut only. So that you can actually adjust how much tightness you want, okay? But this one, it works automatically, okay? So we cannot set the tightness. Why? Because in bend areas like this, okay, the sheet metal will not be easy to hold here, okay? It will try to come out. So if it is too much bent, then we can go for a wing nut fastener, all right? So these two special fasteners, they're using in assembly areas, okay, mostly. Suppose in maintenance, during some major maintenance, if you are replacing some long rivet, suppose you are replacing a big panel from aircraft and there are some 10-20 rivets are there, then we can go for these fasteners. Alright. So by this, I'm concluding the holding tools. Actually, this is a simple, it's actually a short topic. Okay. So remember the different types of pliers and its use, types of clamps and vices and its use. And the last part we have seen, the safety wiring and special fasteners. Alright. So if you have any doubts, I will share my notes with you. Read it. If you have any doubts, you can mail me anytime. Alright. Until then, it's goodbye. Take care.